Topic number four in managerial economics is pricing theory. Pricing theory. And what is the background here? The background is, as we have said always, managerial economics really is all about making decisions. Decisions in the world of business, but then making use of economic theory, economic analytical tools in making exactly those decisions. And part of the decisions that will be made in the context of managerial decision making is decisions related to pricing. We discussed the production a little bit, but then we said when we're producing goods and services, at the end of the day, we would like to sell them in the market. We won't give them for free, really. We'll sell them, and we are going to sell them at a price. We are going to sell them at a price. So managerial decision makers have to understand and make a decision on, you know, what price to charge for that good service that really one is offering into the market. Now, you need a lot of managerial economic analytical tools to be able now to make those kind of decisions. So essentially, we are saying price should be one of the key factors in managerial decision making, because at the end of the day, price that you charge or you don't charge will influence your level of profitability. And we have said the theory that we're using in managerial economics really is the theory of the frame. Theory of the frame, where the key issue, the baseline, is a profit making, profit maximization. In order to profit maximize, for sure, you have to cost minimize. But then at the end of the day, the price that you charge is extremely, extremely important. For managerial decision makers, we'll need to understand issues related to determinants of price, for example, saying what is it that determines the price of a good or a service. Yeah, this will include, for example, things like a supply and demand. We are saying in a free market economy where the free interplay of market forces of supply and demand are allowed to play, then supply and demand will be a key issue within the prices that one is charging. We would say, for example, the higher the demand in a market, the higher the price of a good service, and vice versa, depending really on the context, because of course this vice versa and this ceteris paribus is a condition that has to be fulfilled. But also we are saying prices will also depend a lot on the demand. Will depend on the demand for a good that we are saying. If a good is more demanded, then its price tend to be high. It will depend on the price of other commodities. For example, the price of a substitute good will depend on the price of the other good which can substitute it immediately. And we would say, for example, you cannot really hike the price of substitute goods without being affected. If the prices of, let's say, call it Pepsi Cola goes up, then before one makes that decision, one has to consider what happens with the price of a substitute, for example, Coca-Cola for that matter. Also, the other thing will depend on the objective of a firm. In the context of a theory of the firm, we are saying the objective is always profit making and profit maximizing. So really, prices will be tending towards that goal. If we are talking in the context of a not-for-profit organization, which is not really a subject matter in managerial economics as such, then maybe the objective may not really be so much about profit making, profit maximization. So really, that would not play a big role in here. But also, the other thing that may determine price maybe government policy, government regulation, government intervention. Yeah, if we need a state-controlled economy, and Tanzania once was in such a state in between 1967 to be 1980s when we had Ujamaa, where we had a pricing commission, where it was not the market, but it was the government that would be setting prices. Now you could see price was not really going with the law of supply and demand, but would go with the pricing commission. You know, prices will be fixed. But now we are having, for example, exactly now, when we are, yes, in the market economy, yet we are having regulators. We are having regulatory authorities, which are kind of influencing, maybe not totally fixing, but influencing prices. EWURA, Energy and Water Utilities Regulatory Authority, as a regulator, would kind of give an indication, will give kind of what we call indicative prices for the goods and services that it is regulating. Sumatra will be doing exactly the same. Bank of Tanzania in the context of financial services will be doing exactly the same. So we should understand it very broadly. Yes, market forces of supply and demand may determine price, but also government policy. We once saw here government putting a price on the kilo of sugar. Whether this was observed or not, that is another thing. But then this tells us really at the end of the day, maybe supply and demand is really the key in a free market, in a free market economy. So when we're making decision on pricing, really those are part of the key issues that we should understand. But then we should understand also what are the possible pricing methods. Yeah, if I'm to price my goods and services, what are the technique, what are the methods that I can use? Yeah, there are quite a number, and let it suffice to mention some of few here that are very basic. And one of those is what we call a cost plus pricing. Cost plus pricing. This is a pricing technique where a managerial decision maker will say, yes, I'm pricing my good or service, but then I have to cover my cost of production plus a reasonable profit margin. Now, this reasonability of a price margin will depend on a number of issues, as we are going to see, for example, on market structure that I'm going to explain a little bit later. But then the key issue is make sure that you cover all your cost of production plus a reasonable profit margin. Other pricing technique will be what we call a psychological pricing. Under psychological pricing, this is a situation where you put a price with what we call a hitting price mark. When we say this good or service is sold at 99.9 shillings or 99.9 US dollar, 99.9 euro or 999 shilling. You could see psychologically one sees that, yes, it's only 99.9, it's not 100, so they buy. But then actually once they give you the 100 dollar, there is no change really that is coming back. This is really what we call a psychological pricing. The other type of pricing is what we call a value-based pricing. And a value-based pricing is this situation where you let the consumer of a good or service decide the price he or she pays for a service. In this context, you want to offer a service, and when you ask how much should I pay, and then the one who produced the service will say, please look at yourself, decide by yourself, see the value that you get, that you have gotten from this service or good, and then please decide price on yourself. So we are not really going to discuss more about those many other types, but then there are issues like a discount pricing, there are issues like a penetration pricing, etc. A discount price, this is a situation where you reduce price. For example, if you want to introduce a new product in the market, sometimes when markets are almost about to be expire, you may give discount. When you are having seasons, if it's Christmas, if it's Eid, if it's Easter, one may decide to give a discount for various purposes, attracting customers, etc. But then it is very important to connect pricing theory to what we call market structure, because the way one prices his or her good or service will depend a lot on the market structure. And when we're talking about market structure, we are looking at issues related to competition. We are looking at between the buyer and the consumer, who's got the power. If we are in a market where consumers have power than the sellers, then it is really the consumers who've got the power in making decisions when it comes to pricing. For example, in a very competitive market structure, where it's a market with a lot of producers, with a lot of suppliers, then indeed in this market it is the producers, it is the consumers, it is the buyers, it is those who are in the demand side of the economy who have got the power. Why? Because when you're having cutthroat competition, then prices really, one has to set prices very carefully. The price margin will be relatively low, because if you hike the price a little bit, then we consumers go to your competitors. So this has to be very well understood, as opposed to a situation, for example, when we are in a monopolistic market. Monopolistic market is this market where we are having one producer and so many buyers. In this context, we say the monopolist is, or rather can be, a price maker and a quantity adjuster. So in this context, really, monopolist has got the power. So it's very important when making prices, one has to consider, in what market structure am I in? If I'm in a very competitive market structure, really it is the consumers, it is the buyers who've got the power on kind of price that they are making, because there are so many competitors that are around. I hike price a little bit, they go elsewhere. But then when I'm in a monopolistic market structure, when as a producer, as a seller, I'm at liberty indeed of increasing price, although regulatory authorities will come and make sure that you are not abusing your market power as a monopolist. Maybe the last market structure that we are talking, and just in passing, is what we call monopsony. monopsony. Monopsony is a market structure where we are having one buyer and many sellers. It's a mirror image, I would say, of monopoly. And what are the examples? Monopsonistic market structure would include, for example, in those, should I call them bad old days, when cooperatives, we are the only ones who are supposed to be buying goods. Okay, and Sue will be the only one buying, for example, coffee. Then was a monopsony in the sense that I'm the only buyer and you all have to come and sell to me. In this context, it was the buyer who's got the power to decide price. But then now that things have changed, where now the market is rather competitive, where I may not necessarily sell my crops, my coffee, my whatever, to the cooperative, I can sell it to the private buyers, if this is allowed, then you see that now the monopsonistic market power has been reduced. So those are the key issues, just some of the key issues in pricing and price making for managerial decision maker. And the emphasis is when you make a decision on which price to charge, really you have to be informed by exactly those things. You also have to be informed about what we call elasticity, you know, what we call the price elasticity of demand, for example. In which case, we have to say, yes, elasticity, you know, it is this degree of responsiveness of, for example, if we have the price elasticity of demand is the degree of responsiveness of the quantity demanded as a result of change in price. So it's not really the question of hiking price. The question is my good price elastic or price inelastic? If it is price elastic, you increase prices and there are alternatives, then consumers will run away from you. They'll go and buy elsewhere. If the good or a service is what you call a price inelastic, well, and they have no alternative, they may just stay. Because yes, price increases, but if it is inelastic, then they cannot really change the quantity demanded, etc., etc. Therefore, it is very important for managerial decision makers to make use of economic analytical tools when making decisions in pricing. It's not the question of just pricing. The question is the prices that you make have to be informed by those economic analytical tools that we have just outlined in this topic on pricing and pricing theory.